bedroom to the boardroom. How many Missy Adaba? How was your week? Or how is it so far? Okay, good, nice. All right, good, nice. I like that. It isn't. Okay, just stay with us. Somehow you get to have your groove back. You catch your groove and you catch something at the end of the day. So what do I have today? I don't know. There's really no topic for today's session, but I'll just call it a conversation with fill in the blanks. Now this guy, we haven't spoken, but we've exchanged messages back and forth. When are you coming? I'm listening. I'll try. But finally, he's here. And we're just going to just have a conversation with him, sharing thoughts on different things. We're going to be talking about his beliefs, his value systems, family, and you know, anything and everything. This is not the one that you want to call in. I just want you to listen and hear his own side of the story on whatever it is we're going to be talking about. Once again, it's a men's room. Thanks for joining in. Take a quick break, and when we come back, I'll let you in on who I have and the chat we're going to have. Stay with us. So welcome back. He's an actor, he's a grandpa, he's a life coach, he's somebody's husband. He's been around the entertainment industry long enough. Movies, back and forth. He hasn't started singing. Would he start singing? I don't know. It can happen. But let's keep our fingers crossed and eyes on the screens and see what happens. But he's been around long enough. Toast of everybody. What else can I say now? He's simply RMD, Richard Mofe Damijo. Finally got him into the men's room. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
There we go. He's for real, ladies and gentlemen. He's for real. So how have you been?
I've been good. Been good.
All right. So like I did say, it's a platform where we just talk men talk, you know. And sometimes we have conversations that are usually held in the beer parlors and sports arenas, but in a meaningful way, in a way where we can get some form of resolutions. And sometimes we get answers, other times we don't, but we just bring topics out there. You're not going to be in a spotlight. Oh, you are in the spotlight, but it wouldn't be too hard. We'll just have conversations on a whole lot of things that you'll find easy to talk about.
But you do know that sometimes most discussions or conversations in men's room are supposed to stay in men's rooms.
Let's ask Donald Trump that.
So like if we talk about grabbing stuff, we won't have to.
Well, it depends.
Pay,
I mean, I could
grab somewhere along the line, you know.
I could grab me a bottle of Coke or a bottle of, you know, soft drink or something.
Okay. Or juice.
But depends on what you're grabbing. Actually.
PJ, pineapple juice.
Well, there you go. There you. Well, you know, they call me OJ, orange juice. Anyway, thank you so much for coming once again. I really appreciate you having to come to the studio, understanding your schedule is crazy, is busy, is tight. By the way, how do you combine all of these things? I mean, you're an actor, you're a grandpa, family man, you write, you're a life coach, you have, your plate is full. I mean, you're acting here, you're doing commercials there. How do you balance this with family? These are different hats that have to be worn at different times. How do you play them out?
Well, it is difficult, but I really don't concentrate on coping. So I just cope. Truth be told, sometimes some things will have to give or suffer. I'm a family man, so I tend to place priority on family. I'm heavy on family. For me, I'm like a darling, you know, family comes first. So I try to, you know, give my family as much time as possible. I'm also at a point where all my kids are not with me.
They're not so dependent on you, so to speak. They're all grown. One is married,
is married and has made me a grandfather twice over.
Wow. So how do you feel?
Ecstatic. I'm looking forward to July when I'll go see him, see my new grandson. So, you know, I just have my daughter here, so it's a bit easier to deal with family. You just have to work FaceTime a lot more, and then every quarter I try to go out there and spend time with them.
Okay.
For work, I've always been very restless. I think my theater background sort of makes me work a lot more than I would have worked ordinarily if I was, say, a banker.
Mm-hmm.
When you are a creative, you come out here and you just do whatever comes in your direction. So
sometimes unplanned.
Yes, absolutely. Most times, I became a lawyer because I needed to spend, you know, take some time off a family tragedy that hit me. And at some point, it unveiled me like it was supposed to be this huge plan I had to be political. You know, and then I got called to do some work in government for 8 years. And I'm back to the temple of my family, what I like doing best, which is be a creative and stay in the creative space. Now I'm trying to learn the business of the creative, the business of the show.
Which I think a whole lot of us are yet to grasp. You know, we get carried away with the fanfare and, you know, face out there and all of that, and forget the fact that there's a business angle that should sustain that. And at the end of the day, we're left high and dry.
Well,
so you're saying this now.
Yeah, ordinarily, I shouldn't really have to bother about the business side of it. I mean, if I'm a creative, somebody else should do that.
Mm-hmm.
But as
with everything, where we are.
As with everything in Nigeria, you have to be your own everything, from Minister of Defense to Water Supply and Minister
exactly.
of Light and everything. Light. So I'm having to sort of manage myself, in a sense. Mm. You know, yes, I do have management and all that.
But you sit on top of it.
Yes, you sit on top of it. And sometimes it makes the area that you really would love to thrive suffer. I always say to people that I teach that I want to clock in and out every day as an actor. Mm. That's basically what
so
I've always
you that,
wanted
that full
to be.
Concentration.
Yes, that's basically what I've always wanted to be. That's all I want to be. But you are not allowed to do that because like the Latin phrase we say, noblige oblige, position imposes.
Mm.
Because of what I am, putting the food on the table, bringing the bacon back home, you have to just be wear a lot
of
caps.
Yes.
Bring your A game every time you show up.
Amazing. You were a reporter once.
Yes, I reported. I wrote features.
Yeah.
I started out as a freelance for The Guardian, African Concord, African Guardian, and then I became a staff writer, actually. I didn't do hardcore reporting.
Mm.
I started out as a staff writer in Concord newspapers after I had freelanced for Guardian, most of all the publications of The Guardian. This, by the way, was in the 80s. I left school in 83 and then served 83, 84. So I hit Lagos running, actually. I did everything in Lagos. This is what, 33 years post-promotion, and we're still working.
Amazing. Did you see yourself coming this far? I mean, in all of them, hitting Lagos running and all of that, did you see yourself being where you are now?
Well, I don't know if I saw myself as where I am now. Perhaps a lot more bigger, perhaps. I thought that by now I should be running what ideally I'm heading towards right now, running a one-stop shop for
everything
creative, which I'm trying to now only just put together. I guess also in life you make some detours that, you know, serve some other purpose.
Yeah.
I have absolutely no regrets about spending 8 years in government, you know.
How did that play out? I mean, there you were, you know, in the feel and in the smoothness of what you know how to do, and all of a sudden it's politics,
like being
government.
It's like being uprooted, right?
it
played out for me. It was just a chance to be up close and personal with my people.
Mm.
You know how Lagos tends to make you see more of the veneer, but going back home to serve, I was able to witness, you know, everything in real time.
Mm.
You know, you see the palpable hunger and deprivation and everything, and The first thing that hits you as a newcomer when you get into government is ascribing to yourself this ability to solve all and do all.
Exactly.
Yes. You see the potential.
That's energy. That's
you see the potential to do good, and you start out doing that until the bureaucracy creeps in, and you begin to gradually.
And that's not good. Is it?
No. That's what kills government. I say, you know, rather sadly that it's like government in Nigeria is designed, or in Africa is designed to fail. Ab initio.
You're not the first person saying that.
It's sad, but that's what the reality is. And embracing it is not enough. There has to be. We have to do much more than talking about it.
Yeah.
And start re-engineering it, retweaking it, retooling it, rekitting it. Everything that we can do to make life better. Institutionalize everything that has to do with government so that having light does not depend on the style or quality of the minister for energy. Having good roads doesn't depend on the government.
It's just
power.
A basic need that
yes,
needs to be
it just it's work that is ascribed to an institution and it just gets on. Why do I have to have a super performing Minister of Transportation or Aviation to have a functional airport where just picking and dropping of passengers is being made to look like it's some rocket science.
Mm.
You know, it's tough, but hey, that's what it is. And
do you see yourself going back?
I don't know that you know I'm a fan of the movies. You know that thing that they say never say never.
Yeah.
But I'm not the type that can run for elective office.
Mm.
I don't think so. I don't have the gumption to do.
What
that.
If called to give it a shot or do something?
Well, it has to be really palpable. I'm a spiritual man, and no apologies for that.
Mm.
It has to sit with me.
Yeah.
Because I've lived. All this while, and I sort of came to a point where I heard, you know, I was very comfortable spiritually by the time I was leaving that.
Mm-hmm.
I had done my bit, so to go back there, I must have that kind of clarity. You know.
Well, coming back to the spiritual aspect, but in recent times, suicidal rates have been quite alarming, especially for guys. Matter of fact, statistics has it that men, you know, commit suicide much more than women, and this revolves around, most times it revolves around the economy, the finances, funds, and all of that. What's your take on this, especially for men? Yes, but for men who just jump into the lagoon, take their lives, and all of that.
I don't want to speculate, but I read sometime many years ago when I was in my 30s, I experienced midlife crisis pretty early in my life. I was like 33 when I experienced midlife crisis.
Wow.
And I read stuff about Japan, how people my age were considered unemployable, you know, because of the pressure of how you have to be at a certain age to be able to have achieved certain things, and once you get into your 30s, mid-30s and late-30s, if you're not an achiever at that time, then you're like, you know. So I think that in today's digital age and in a shrinking world and in a world that is being, where everything is being democratized, so to speak, the world is shrunk a lot more, and so there are palpable pressures on people. So when you belong to a certain age demographic and you think that you are supposed to have been at this stage in your life and you're not there, the pressures get to you. And if you don't have any avenue for escape or to relieve such pressure, then some people break. You know, it's sad, but you know, we live in a society where we don't document, we don't have structures that take care of.
There's nothing, you know, to account to.
Yes. So we end up speculating on stuff like this until. Just imagine a world where there was no social media, where you don't get the news in real time, where news does not depend on organizations that are new, like news organizations, because all the things you're hearing today, we probably have always had them, but because people, you don't find people there, real-time pictures, snap it, put it on WhatsApp, or go online, the number of bloggers that we have, and the information is at your fingertips. Mm-hmm. So perhaps it is just coming to our knowledge that a lot more of us are dying, you know, prematurely because they're giving in to the pressure. Mm. Some people manifest in other ways, prostitution, increase in drug trafficking, and,
in fact,
and all of that. So social vices just tend to spiral out of control.
Yeah. You know, I had a psychologist in the other day, and we talked about this, and shortly after we spoke, by the time we went downstairs to my office, her phone was like a Christmas tree. Folks calling in and sending in messages that, hey, look, I need help. I'm at the verge. So there's a whole lot of, you know, just taking it from the pressure you talked about, a whole lot of people going through a whole lot of pressure that they either they cannot talk about or the environment doesn't warrant it being talked about and all of that. And so it's quite, it tells on us negatively. And especially when a man takes his life, when a father takes his life, when he's not there anymore. I mean, it's all bad when a woman does, but when the father figure is gone, it's demoralizing.
I was privileged to be in a company of some young women who, my daughter was turning 30, and I just dropped the topic everywhere I met young people. I just discovered that a lot of them freaked out or were freaking out at being 30 because of the pressures they were going through. And these things, they manifest later on in all kinds of things. And I wish that society would be a lot more bearable. I wish there were a lot more things to be joyful about, you know, where systems were. You can, it's like being in a bus stop somewhere in civilized places and you know that the next bus is in 15 minutes or 5 or
so
10.
You can time it,
depending on what is advertised. Give and take away another 5 minutes for mishaps here and there, but you know there will be a next one. But you can be in an airport where you paid money, top dollar for a flight, and you're not offered any kind of explanation for delays and all that. It's a tough continent we live in, you know, where some friends of mine in Cameroon have their internet yanked off in the Anglophones in Cameroon right now. They don't have internet. You know, that's the kind of leadership we're dealing with, where whole rights can be yanked off. Dealing with people who express their frustration just by blowing up stuff, you know, and blowing up lives. It's tough. It's a tough time we all live in.
How do you navigate through the tough times? You have had to. Matter of fact, look, people see you now and they're, RMD, he's arrived, he's there and all of that. They see you in the glory of the industry. You've been through a whole lot. Talk us through some of these things.
Well, like I said, I'm a spiritual man, and I really, really do find solace in the words of God, you know, because earlier today, I'm part of a forum, a creative forum, and we're talking about finding stardom. And I was saying that a film doesn't make you a star. It's beyond that. It can give you exposure. Being a star is an enthronement thing, you know, from people, it's public adulation and all of that. And so for me, navigating the hard times and everything, there are times when I cry. As a man, I cry. I mean,
really?
I watch movies and I cry. I'm flying.
My goodness.
I'm a softie for music, for good movies. And so I find that when I'm at that point where everything is like closing in, I take solace in the word from the Bible. I look at my kids. I count my blessings. And I also have a mindset of, if there is a problem, then there is also a solution.
Mm-hmm. It might take some time to get to the solution, but yes. Sitting down and boiling or building castles, you know, and painting the
pitching
problem.
Your tent, yes, the problem.
Yes, like yeah. Well, like they say, throwing a pity party wouldn't make a difference. I mean, you can throw a pity party to just get to that point where it can
it
rise.
Springs you
yeah,
up,
springs
yeah.
you up. But yeah. after that, you are basically on your own. I say prayer and I move on. Mm. It's tough. You know, I don't want to sound conceited, but the truth of the matter is, you have to have something that you hang on to.
It's got to be an anchor.
Yes, the thing I hang on to and I hold on to steadfastly is God's love. What have you to lose if there is assurance that God has got your back? Mm. Why don't you just believe?
Yeah.
and then see how it works for you. That's all I can offer you. Really. I can speak to you. I can try to inspire you. I can try to do all that I can do. But after that, what it really comes down to is that I don't have answers to how the world was formed. Mm. But if I do believe in a higher being and how the world was formed, and if the person who formed me or the lineage that I came out of tells me of some certainty or with some certainty that he's got me, I've got to rely on that whenever less feels.
Bless your assurance.
Yes.
The men's room is what we're listening to right now, or the men's room is what you are listening to right now. Onimisi Adaba hanging out with the veteran himself, RMD, aka Richard Mofe Damijo. We'll take a quick break, and when we come back, we'll give you a concluding part of the show. Please stay with us. Onimisi Adaba hanging out with RMD, Richard Mofe Damijo. Yep. And it's, for me, it's an honor having him in the studio, hanging out with him here, and, you know, hearing his thoughts. Fantastic. Great. The same for you? Really? But we're in the same boat. And he's got more till the top of the hour. All right. So, thanks for coming.
Thank you. It's pleasure to be here.
Now, before we went on break, you spoke lonely about your spirituality. That gives you where you get the anchor, the balance, you know, from which, you know, every other thing flows and all of that. And again, hearing that, one would think you've got it all on lockdown and all of that. You suffered a loss a couple of years ago. How did you deal with that?
Same way. I remember my pastor at the time walked in and his wife gave me a book. I will never forget that book. What God gives you when you lose something. Yeah. What God gives when you lose something. And that helped me go through that period. Mm. And of course, you are encouraged to know that, especially if the person was also a spiritual being, you know that she's in a better place. I see my daughter now and she's 30. Mm. It's like it's
you see her.
I see her and I see the progress she's made and the little time she's been back home. And I'm just happy. You end up looking at she used to say something which I love. It used to be our mantra. Living well is the best revenge. Mm. That was her mantra and our mantra. So that has stayed with me. You try to live well, you know, something happens, you move on. At first, you know, it was tough. I said, oh, I'll never get married again because I was haunted in a sense. Because you start feeling that, like, what would you do if for any reason you lose another one? Mm. So, but, you know, God has been faithful.
Wow, good to know. You know, they say even Superman has his kryptonite. Mm-hmm. What is your kryptonite?
Since you put it like that, I don't know what I don't think I have that kind of. Again, it goes back to
your spirituality.
Spirituality. Mm. So, I don't have an externalized fetish or anything. Again, that's it for me.
Now, in society, one of the disturbing and alarming things happening right now is the rate of sexual abuse and domestic violence all over the place. On this show, I've had people come share their stories, we've heard, and fortunately, Lagos State Government has taken that up head on, and so far, so, I mean, they're trying the best they can. I'm asking because most of what we hear, the perpetrators, are men, you know, out of one reason or the other, for one reason or the other, or something, you know. They are the abusers, they are the, they're there, you know. What message can you give? What message do you have in this regard?
On a larger scale, on a societal level, it's important because you mentioned Lagos State. When there is no sanction, when there is no punishment for a misdeed, men tend to play God or just get away with anything. You know, I think that if our laws are a little bit more active, you know, men will probably pause before they do stuff. Yeah. I mean, look at what happens to the average Nigerian man in a flight when he goes abroad and he lands in England, in London, for instance, and the air hostess says, please stay on your seat, you know, until the plane comes to a final stop.
Yeah.
And they do that. And then that same man comes on that same flight, flies back to Nigeria, and that announcement comes over the phone, you know, and he doesn't, he's like, I'm home, what's the worst that can happen? Yeah, if I'm handed over to the police, I'll do something else. But he knows that if he's handed over to, you know, foreign police or whatever, he will have to pay the full price. So, you know, to that extent, I hope that the law can actually be activated to the point where people who do such inhuman things will have to face the full brunt of the law. I am a father, and I have a young daughter who is just 14. When she was younger, I know the pressure that my wife and I go through when we have to send them on an errand, or when somebody has to go out with them. Mm-hmm. They want to go buy ice cream or just go down the road.
And you
whatever.
See, for them, that's how they see it. It's as simple as that.
You know.
But for the parent, the things you just build in and you're like,
you know, so you have to get the nanny is not enough, you have to get a cousin who is who you think cares enough, you know, you have to, you know, instruct them, like, if anybody touches you wrongly, you know, tell me, you know, that kind of thing. And before you know, you're scaring the kid, because
kid will be like, I'm just going out to buy this.
Yes,
and why arm me with so many people and so much information?
They're looking at you and you're like, you know, so why is daddy getting so, we just wanted dominoes.
So
why is daddy getting all worked up, you know?
I spoke with a lady who runs a home that takes care of sexually abused children and all of that. And, you know, she wrote a book, and I brought the book home, and I'm like, guys, we need to. And my daughter was like, why do you need to read it to us? Is this not for adults? You know, wrote a book on sexual abuse and all. I'm like, yes, it's what adults do to children. So it's for everybody
to know. It's
frightening.
I mean, there are kids who you would rather. I mean, look at the innocence of a kid. That a 5-year-old sees somebody, father says, oh, this is uncle this, or this is auntie this, and they just run to you and they hug you,
innocence.
Give me a kiss, they kiss you. And having to sit the child down and start saying to them, if uncle touched you, it's crazy.
It just messes up
everything. I mean, look at today, you don't even. A guy scoops up a child. If I'm abroad, I need to tell the story. You know, my daughter dotes on me, right?
Yes.
And so, if we go out, we travel out. I put her and a brother in a room. My daughter will break my door down to sleep on my bed.
Yeah.
You know. Mm-hmm. So, how do I tell my 6-7-year-old daughter that you can't stay on my bed? How? You know, it's very difficult. But in America, there are things that, you know, you can't do. You can't be, your daughter runs to you in public and holds you, or you hold your daughter in a way. People are looking at you like, you're
like,
crazy. You know, and these are things that are not cultural to us. So we live in a world, like I said, that it's being redefined, it's evolving in ways that might not sit well with us because of the values, some of the values that we hold. But we just have to keep improvising as we go along. It is tough, but that's what fatherhood and being in the, you know, living in today, you know.
Living not, in today's yeah, time. Yeah. Crazy. Yeah. All right, still on family. You know, I again on the show, I had a chat with a couple who turned 50, celebrated, you know, 50 years of life together, their wedding anniversary and all of that. And one of the things they shared was the fact that they were able to go through the rough, tough, crazy times of lack together, you know, and, you know, went through that phase with the coolness of it's going to get better, it's just for a phase. You know, and they're better off right now. I mean, this was years ago, they're 50, they just celebrated 50. And, you know, I see it against today where I think, I see and I hear that money is everything. If you ain't got no money, forget it. Forget it. I mean, money talks and the other one walks. What's your take on this? I mean, has it changed that bad?
I think the young people I work with tell me things have really changed. There are still a few people, young people who have these values, the values that I'm 56 this year, and there are still a few young people that have their heads.
You look young for 56, by the way.
Thank you. Good. Thank you.
I want to be like you when I get
there. Thank you. Yeah, there are young people whose heads are, you know, screwed on well on their shoulders, and but I'm also told that there are people who go into marriages now not for the reasons that some of us went in there. Mm. You know, I can look my wife in the face and say, baby, we don't have right now. And she will improvise, you know. There are younger couples who don't go through all of that, who don't have the same values. Time was when, you know, I wonder if how a young couple, maybe couples in their 30s now, will feel if they go into a marriage and suddenly one loses his or her job. I wonder how they cope, because I hear the values are different. I'm trying to understand it.
Trust me, I'm trying myself.
Let me tell you the best compliment I've had in all my life as a father. I go spend some time with my son and his wife in Canada, and before I leave, I was saying to my daughter-in-law that, hey, by the way, I hope he treats you right, because you know I can still kick his ass. You know, all you need to do is tell me, because I wouldn't want him to treat you any less.
Yes.
You know, and she says to me, Dad, I don't say this to make you feel good, but you raised a good man. And that day I felt like the, you know, I felt the heavens just open and say hallelujah for me. You don't find that easily. So when I was my sister-in-law when we were watching Big Brother, and she was talking about how difficult her son is. What, 21? He just graduated school, and she was telling me about how it is so difficult to find good men. You know, and so when women find them, you know, they practically are their mothers and everybody. They are practically coming at them, you know, to secure these young men.
Hold him up.
Yes, in their 30s or in their 20s that are 20 but going on 50. Mm-hmm. You know, I think society needs to get back to the basics of having values that are not determined or that are not defined by money.
Money has just been the center of everything, the expense of values.
I think, in a way, to the collapse of governance, you know, at all levels, has also eroded our values, because the things that ordinarily shouldn't be driven by money are now having to be driven by money, and you have to provide for all of that. So it just turns the scale upside down. And so women are looking for men that can take care of their needs.
Yeah.
You know, after all, they'll tell you when it suits them that the traditional concept of marriage is that the man is supposed to provide for the woman.
Yeah.
Providing for me means, well, if it is Brazilian hair I'm going to get, then you have to give me Brazilian hair or whatever. If I want a house in Lekki, and then it has to be a house in Lekki.
Yeah.
You know, that kind of thing. So I hear things that happen in Lekki and the housewives of Lekki and all that kind of thing. I shudder to think that it's true, but hey,
it is true.
We deal with it if you say so. I haven't been a witness to it, but it's the story that comes out from these young people's mouth is frightening. And that they even embrace it and say
now that's the reality. Thing. I mean, you're just hitting it as you're moving on for the fact that it is embraced. You know,
deal with it. This is what is Uncle Richard. Come on, you know, where do you come from? This is what the reality is. Deal with it. You're very well and good, but hey, deal with it. You know, it's frightening, but
my goodness,
thank God for a few good ones.
Yeah, a few good ones. You know, I you know, let me not go there. We could go on and on and on of that, but let's come back to your movies now. I mean, you've been around as much as I remember you in Checkmate. I can't remember the name now, but one of the things you used to do was, you know, just to scratch your nose.
Kadri.
You know, scratch the nose and, you know, have that husky voice and I'm like, this bad guy, you know. How many movies have you done? I mean, I remember that and I know you started from 19. I don't.
My first movie was actually like a real 35mm, you know, movie. Shot by the Afolabi brothers. You know, one of them became the director, DG of Nigerian Film Corporation. But for Nollywood, what we know today as Nollywood, my first movie was in 1995.
Out of Bounds?
No, it wasn't Out of Bounds. Out of Bounds was 97. That was my first produced written movie. Yeah. It was Ameze Mayagwe's movie. Ameze produced that movie. I'm sure the name will come to me at some point.
I'm sure you've lost count of how many.
I think that in my generation, I probably have the least number of movies in my catalog. My body of work doesn't go beyond 60.
Wow.
Now I said that it's funny, right? Because that's what some of these young folks do in 2 months or in 3 months, you know. So when I tell people that I haven't even done 70 films, they look at me like it's not possible, you know. But I've been blessed. I've chosen well, and the movies and the projects I've done, they've been very good. I mean, I've been back now to like less than 2 years,
yes.
And I came back with like. With a vengeance.
With a bang.
You know,
I mean,
I remember last year, there was a time I had like 3 movies in theater. But for an actor, it was very revealing for me because they were very different movies, you know. And so there was a Loibiri, there was Dinner, there was The Grudge, and then, you know, the wedding party came, you know. So it was really, really seeing me in different shape. And then I was in Hush. You know?
Oh yes.
Yes, and recently, a few weeks ago, Hush was doing its final grand finale, the final episode of Hush, and on that same day, Okafor's Law was premiering as well. So you know,
it's been back to back.
One of those magical moments. So yes, perhaps with all of that credit that I brought in, I probably have done 65.
Wow.
Yes.
Well, do you? Yes, you've schooled for it, and you read for it, and you practice and all of that, but do you have role models, people you watch and you're like,
wow? Oh, yes. I mean, I've been, first and foremost, I must give credit. I always say that Jimmy Sholanke was one of the reasons why I am what I am today.
Wow.
As a young boy in Bendel State, when we watch Bendel Playhouse, it was Jimmy Sholanke played, and I saw that. I was like, man, this guy is something else. I mean, I had always been an actor. I mean, from primary school and all that, dramatic society and all that. I was always playing, you know, a lead character. I loved drama all my life. And so when I studied theater, it was the question of, well, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life. I came to Lagos and said, this is what I want to do.
I mean, so you knew it. It wasn't as if it just fell on you.
No. And for that, you know, Lou Jacobs, just seeing your own countrymen.
Yeah.
At a point, newscasters were part of our inspiration. Shaw, Molly, and Cole, you know, were part of our inspiration. Patrick O'Kane, you know, just being on television. And of course, for foreign actors, I love Denzel. You know, not for the fact that he's just black, but because of the positive life that he lives outside of the school.
No, I mean, Denzel,
you know,
is
and the intensity with which he carries himself and his craft. And so for me, I've always worked on my craft to the point where if I have a chance to stand in front of an audience or for a film, I know that what I am is because the audience approves it. Mm-hmm. And so you don't ever take them for granted. Yeah. So I make sure that every time that I have an opportunity to stand before people as an actor, I do it to the best of my ability so that there is no mistake in the fact that when they see me, they're like, oh, wow, this guy is still there, he's still working it.
Still got the juice in.
Yes, he's still bringing his A game. Because you can actually kick back and say, well, I got them.
Yeah. Yes.
But you don't. Every opportunity to be something else or to be somebody else in the movie, you don't. I belong to that school that says there is no small role. There are no small roles. There are only small actors. And I'm not a small actor.
So. Just like a saying that goes, there's never a boring story. But a boring storyteller.
Yeah.
So it depends on how you interpret the story.
Yeah.
Which of the movies really stands out to you? Out of all the movies you did last year, I mean, all of them big back-to-back and all of that, but which really registers with you?
The one that registers with me more is Oloibiri, because I lost weight. From 120, I climbed down to like 95, 96 kg.
How did you do that? I'm trying to lose weight now. So.
You don't need to lose that much weight. I changed my lifestyle. It's not a diet, because a diet is like a program.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't do like a program. Mm-hmm. It's more like a changing your entire lifestyle, your eating habit, your drinking habits and everything. Yes, I've kicked back a little bit. Took my food off the shuttle, but I'm working my way back onto it now because I'm going to be on television again very soon. So
okay.
I want to make sure that, which again, it comes back to what I said earlier, never ever take your audience for granted. You need to look your best.
Mm.
Let them even see some work in progress in you, and then they will, you know.
I mean, if for nothing, somebody might just be watching you for the first time.
That's right.
So you must
make sure that you resonate. So, you know, somebody's heard about you, comes to the theater and say, oh, this is RMD you're talking about. Let me even see what he is in this film. So if it is a moment I have in the movie, the Okafor's Law, I don't think I have more than 5 to 10. I don't think I have up to 10 minutes screen presence.
Yeah.
But I made sure that my 1 minute counted
counts.
So that when you encounter me, in that time that I'm in there, you must go home with something. And I'm glad that a few people have come. I mean, if Joker Jacobs calls me and says, my brother, you brought it on, then you can sleep easy on that day and say, you know, because she called me and said, I saw the film and you brought, I said, oh, thank you. Anybody else can say anything there, you know. That's my sister right
now. Good to know. And now you have a project you're working on.
Yes.
Talk to us about it.
I'm not sure I'm at liberty to say
it's
it.
Still, it's still hush-hush.
Hush-hush.
Right?
But, well, it's television, and I have like 4 projects I'm actually working on, all as equally important, but all of them leading to more work on television and on film.
Yeah, I'm just looking at how the young folks can benefit from your years. Being a life coach,
I run mentorship programs.
Mm-hmm.
You know, right now I have 2 interns that are working with me, trying to be as teaching them hands on.
Yes.
You know, there are people that most of all my staff members are young people, because I think that I learn a lot from them as well when I'm with them. And I've just launched a website, www.rmdactor.com, which will start, you know, mentoring online, because I can't possibly reach everyone.
Be everywhere.
So I have a lot of things that I'm trying to do to make myself more accessible to people, so that those who want to learn a thing or two from me can do that. It's a heavy responsibility for people to turn to you for direction. Sometimes
and that tells a lot about you.
Yeah. Sometimes I'm not too sure myself what I'm doing, whether I'm doing it right or not.
Actually, at those times is when somehow you know that you're doing it right. When you get to that point, what am I doing? Am I getting it right? Am I in the post and all of that? You're right on course.
Thank you. That's very comforting.
Right, I'm
telling very, very right comforting. Because there are people who think I'm crazy for leaving politics and coming back to to the creative world.
I mean, it's your calling.
Yeah.
It's your calling. I mean, I have
no regrets about that at all.
So we're wrapping up the show in a short while. The Men's Room is what you're listening to, and I have been with RMD, Richard Mofe Damijo. We're just talking generally on everything we can talk about. We wrap up the show in a few minutes. I just wanted to just say something to someone out there who needs to hear that, hey, look, it's going to be okay.
Well, I don't have all the answers. I have moments of doubts myself. Almost 2 years ago, I left government, and my head was clear to me that I'm an actor, and I was missing something, and that's what I want to be. I'm a creative spirit. I'd like to do that. So I came back in here, pitched my tent, and even with all of that self-doubt and everything, what kept coming through was the fact that this is what you are and this is who you are, and if you stick to it, you know, if you keep faith, you know, you will get to that point where all will come together, and that's basically what I'm doing every day. I'm a work in progress. You don't have to be, you know, it's not a 100 meters dash or something. It's a marathon, you know, and I'm determined to make sure that I get to the finish line. The thing to do is not to give up, not to stop working and retooling and re-kitting and retweaking and, you know, just trying to reinvent. The reason why, for instance, you wake up one morning and say, you know what, I'm going to change my entire lifestyle, my approach to life, you know, I'm going to have an upbeat style to life and everything, is all part of the process of getting to that final point where you can kick back and say, finally, I'm here, you know. So if you are in the process of creating something or pursuing your dreams, my advice to you is don't give up. You know, stay in your lane and also believe, have that audacity of belief that, you know, everything will come together. And it will.
So what more can I say? Words coming from the man himself, RMD, Richard Mofe Damijo. He's been there, he's done that. He's got a couple of t-shirts to show you for it. And that's it. It's going to come together. Thank you so much for coming. Really appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.
And so I'll catch you same time, same dial next week. Probably with a different guest, different topic, talk different angles. You can follow us on Twitter at Men's Room OJ. Same address, Men's Room OJ for Facebook. Share your thoughts, drop whatever you want to drop, and we'll take it up from there. Thank you once again. Good night, and God bless you real good.